George for Boxing Now here with Frank Smith. Frank, first of all, it's been a while since I've seen you. How have you been?
I'm very good, thank you. I'm enjoying the sunshine of, you know, November in the UK, November in Birmingham.
It's a bit cold though, isn't it? It's a bit
cold. I love it. I love a bit cold. You know, when it's, as long as it's not raining, as long as the sun is shining and a nice little chill, it's my kind of day.
Very nice day out.
It is a beautiful day.
Well, we'll get straight into it. Obviously, after yesterday's ruling that Conor Benn will be eligible to fight in the UK, do you think he'll apply for his British Board of Control licence back, or do you think he'll just fight on another licence?
I don't know. That's a decision for him to make. We'll speak to him. You know, there's nothing stopping him now from fighting in the UK. He has a licence with a reputable commission in the US. As many fighters, Tyson Fury being one, Dillian White being another, have fought with foreign boxing licences before. But that's a question for him, really, you know, as to how he wants to approach it, and something we'll discuss. You know, it was obviously fresh news. We've been up here, but we'll catch up early part of next week. But just excited now about what's to come and the future.
Well, obviously, it won't be a surprise to you. Simon Jordan doesn't seem satisfied with the ruling and solution of the disclosure. What did you make of that?
Simon Jordan doesn't seem happy.
Yeah.
I mean, Simon Jordan's never happy. But also, he has to be divisive, because otherwise he wouldn't have a job, would he? You know, no, but he has to say things that cause a ripple effect, because that's what keeps him in his job at TalkSport, and that's what he's good at.
Yeah.
You know, but it doesn't mean you can sit there and lie, or you can't. Just the thing is with Conor, I feel like so many people have gone down a route, right, of smashing him, really, and now it's too late to go. The pride and ego of it to go, actually, do you know what? He did what we asked him to. But people asked him to deal with it with the British Boxing Board of Control, right? He did that. He went through a process via UCAD, via the NADP, an independent body who are in place to decide these things, who are specialists within this field, right? They asked him to do it. He did it. He won the case. Rather than go, all right, fair play, as they would with so many other people. How many other people have been through a process, and not even as stringent of a process as Conor Benn, and everyone just gets on with it? But I think you have to separate the two. You have to separate the way things were dealt with. Yes, could we have handled things a bit differently? Could he have approached things differently? Yes, I'm sure. But it's easy for people who aren't in that position, who don't understand what's happening, to say these things. There was so much that went on in the background, but people don't understand the whole thing. They just take snippets and they have a view on it. So you have to, like I say, I can sit here and say, can there be improvements made? Can we handle things that, yes, 100%. Can you question the process he's been through now? No, because he didn't win it on jurisdiction. He went through the process you asked him to do. So just separate the boxes. Say you don't like him, or you don't like us, or you don't like the way, but don't question the decision, because he dealt with it the way you asked him to deal with it. So where does this, it's like a witch hunt that doesn't end, you know. And I get Simon has to be divisive, but rather than say, oh, I'm not happy with it, just say, I think they're tossers. No, but it's much easier.
Yeah.
That's an opinion, and you can have an opinion about anything, but you can't have an opinion about the fact he went through a process that you asked him to go through on the basis that you know absolutely fuck all about the situation. Because it's not, it's like saying to me, can you handle this case? And I go, I don't know where you start, mate, because I have no clue about it.
Yeah.
Let's go through all the evidence. I don't know what I'm looking at. These people, an independent panel, who are nothing to do with boxing, they're an independent panel put in place to make these decisions. They made a decision. What do you want them to go and do now? They'll never be happy. That's my view.
Well, do you think it might be beneficial to publish maybe any part of the 270-page document to see exactly where Conor Benn is coming from?
But can I be... I've had stick for this in the past. It's just like I said, what do you, me, know about any of it? It's not for us to make a decision. You asked him to deal with it with the people who are in charge of this. He did that, and they cleared him. So where does it end? When has anyone ever gone, well, I want to see all the details myself? Like, someone goes to court for something and go, I want to see it all myself. I don't quite believe what's happened here. You know, like, he hasn't served a silent ban. He hasn't served a suspension. Like, he went through the process you asked him to. They came out and said he was cleared and free to fight.
How do you think this will stop then, you know?
I think eventually something else will happen. I think, look, it was such a big event when it was coming round that it was so, the news was so huge. And again, it goes back to the point of, was everything really handled the right way, like, as in, was the approach? Maybe not. But we're big enough, we're grown up enough to say, you know, you don't always make the correct decision, or that you don't say the correct thing at all times. That's what learning's all about, and growing and developing and making sure you do things in a different manner moving forward. The only way it goes away is time. You know, and this is, again, it's fresh news. There's no more news now. Nothing more can come out.
It feels like it's at the end now, where whatever is next is next.
But there's been so many moments where it's been able to be brought up again because this happened, that's happened, this, that, you know, now it's done. You can't say anything else. So I don't know what Simon Jordan is going to talk about. You know, I hope they don't get rid of him at TalkSport, because he is very good, obviously, at what he does. So I hope they keep him in, even though he hasn't got that headline to talk about anymore, you know.
Well, we'll move on to Derek Chisora. Obviously, the last dance was announced, the apparent last dance. We know Derek, you know, hopefully not, but it could be, against Otto Wallin. Are you glad it's his last dance?
I've always been, like, Derek has become a friend, like, outside of boxing for me, someone I respect a lot and get on with very well. I would always have said to him, like, what do you want from the sport? You have boxed everyone, you've boxed in stadiums, you've sold out arenas, you've headlined pay-per-view shows, like, you've made a ton of money. What do you want from the sport, right? So for me, it's like, if my opinion is, I would say, mate, just leave it. But he loves the sport. He loves boxing. It's all he knows, and it's all he wants to do.
Would you rather see him fight Otto or Miller?
I think the build-up for Miller would have been very entertaining.
It's so juicy, wasn't it?
Oh, it would have been unbelievable. Imagine two of them. Dale might have gone back to throwing tables again. But but look, it's Otto is still a relevant heavyweight, you know, and it's going to be an interesting fight, you know. But my view on Derek is what I would say to him as well. It's like, mate, you've had 48 fights against the biggest names in the sport, and you have been a star. Like, he's everywhere you go with him, everyone's like, Derek Chisora, everyone loves him. Yeah, and he is that lovable character, and he's changed as he's got older as well. But I'm happy for Dale. Whatever Dale wants, he's become a mate, and I care about him on a level outside of just business and the sport, you know.
Did you see Drell Miller's outburst where he's blaming Dimitri Salita for the Chisora fight falling through? Have you got no idea?
Didn't see it. No, I didn't see it. So unfortunately, I can't. I got asked some questions about it the other day about the whole situation. And look, I can't really say anything because I don't know the background of it. Do you know what I mean? But you just hope fighters still manage to get opportunities and kept active, and these things don't get in the way, really.
We're going on to another part of the heavyweight. Martin Bacoli seems to be the most avoided heavyweight. Why do you think this is? Why do you think he's not been landed a big fight? Eddie says that he's outpriced himself. People have said other different things. What do you think it is?
I mean, look, we obviously don't represent him. He may have outpriced himself, but I also think he is very good, and he doesn't bring the commercial value to a fight to make someone go, yeah, I'll fight Martin Bacoli. Like, what is the point of fighting Martin Bacoli for a lot of these people? And that's no disrespect to him. Mm-hmm. It's actually just saying, you're good. And it's like, do I really need that? Like, what's it going to do for my career?
Yeah.
You know, and it's part of the case. That's your job as a promoter, to put him in a position where people can't turn him down. And look, he's got the mandatory position, the final eliminator. So if he gets that, they won't have an option.
Yeah. Well, one more before I've got a bit of a different question. Oscar De La Hoya's come out and said that he might veto Ryan Garcia's next fight or exhibition fight. What did you make of that? Eddie says, get the popcorn ready.
Look, I don't know, again, enough about their contractual situation. I think sometimes, I said this the other day, like, we don't have the best relationship always with Oscar De La Hoya, but sometimes the perception and the view is that it's like big promoters coming for just fighters, you know, taking away opportunities. And sometimes there's not enough about, like, the work that goes. Like, we've invested millions of pounds into fighters over the years, right? And, you know, you do have a contract, and that's why contracts are there. And if you weren't delivering for them, rest assured, they'd be coming out at you saying things. So,
yeah.
again, without seeing Oscar's contract and Ryan Garcia's contract, there's not only so much I can say. Mm-hmm. But I do understand if you got contract with someone, you've worked your bollocks off with someone. You know, and look, relationships do change. But at the same time, if you've invested a lot of money and time, you know, and that's not me necessarily defending Oscar because I don't know enough about it, but I've been on the other side of it.
Yeah. And finally from me, we've got one of the biggest darts channels, and I've got to ask you, with the World's Darts Championships coming up, I've got to ask you a prediction.
Do you know what? I'm going to the darts on the first Monday.
Bloody love the darts.
I love the darts. Much better business than our boxing business, I've decided. I can't wait. Everyone's talking about old Luke Littler, isn't he? No, everyone's, he's a man. But I actually think, I'm going to say an outcast, Michael Van Gerwen.
Do you know what? I asked Eddie the same yesterday. He says, in his heart, he wants Luke Littler to win. In his head, he thinks Luke Humphries will win. But Michael Van Gerwen could just come back.
Humphries won the Players' Championship the other day, didn't he? He beat Luke Littler in the final. So, you know,
I think you never know. Don't write Michael Van Gerwen off.
That's why we love the darts. But the mad thing about the darts is they sell 100,000 tickets. You don't even know you're going to watch play.
Yeah. That is
what
true.
What a sport. But I'm buzzing for it. Can't wait to get down there, Ali Pali, going with some mates. It's my one Christmas night off before I fly to Saudi.
Fury Usyk, who have you got?
I don't want to sound like I'm sitting on the fence. You have to say, obviously, Usyk is favourite. But at the same time, I believe that all these guys can beat each other on their best night. Fury was ahead after six or seven rounds against Usyk that night. Usyk, as he does, he found a way. They can beat each other. They're all capable and good enough to beat each other. You have to say Usyk is the favourite, though, going into it.
But I'd love to see Fury win.
I think the AJ fight would happen regardless, but I'd love to see Fury win. You know, he's a big character. And him being the undisputed champion. Oh, sorry. Unified champion, sorry. I mean, would be massive.
Well, thank you so much for your time. It's been great.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Cheers.